What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Exotic Astrology again, and today we will complete our series on solutions to planets in the Dusthanas. Yes, we discussed about planets in the 6th house, in the 8th house, and in the 12th house. All right, so if you have not watched those videos, it is there in this playlist itself, Astrology Secrets, OMG Astrology Secrets, then please go and watch it, all right? Because many people have said that, yes, we have got a better understanding of how to deal with the planets there, irrespective of whichever planet is there in the 6th house or in the 8th house or in the 12th house, all right? So if you have not watched them, please go and watch them, okay? And today is the last Dusthana house, or the mild Dusthana, as they say, because 3rd house is not a very terrible Dusthana, but ultimately it is a Dusthana, yes? So we have to put it in the category of Dusthana houses. Alright. There you go. If you are new to the channel and you have not yet subscribed, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation, then approach me through my website. The link is pasted below in the description. And before I begin, as I say, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and He will definitely help you in the 3rd house, because He is the only one who can help you there. We will see how that is true. Yes, we will discuss about it, okay? And if you want me to make any other video, then please let me know in the comments, okay? All right. Have you heard of this shloka? Mukam karoti vachalam pangum langayate girim yat kripatam aham vande shri gurum dena talinam. You have not heard. If you have heard, then if you know the meaning, then please pause this video and write the meaning of this shloka. Yes, some of you must have heard this. Yes, and if you have not heard about this, then bear it with me till the end. I will explain, because this shloka is very important in the scriptures. This is very frequently used, this shloka. What this means is, mukam karoti vachalam, that even a person who is dumb, who cannot speak, he can also speak. Mukam karoti vachalam. Vacha means to speak. Pangum langhayate girim. Pangum langhayate girim. This means that even a person who cannot walk, a layman, he can also walk. Girim refers to mountains. Langhayate girim. Mukam karoti vachalam. Pangum langhayate girim. Yat kripa tamaham vande. By your grace, Shri Gurum Dina Tarinam. By whose grace? By the grace of the Guru. And who is the Guru here? Guru is in the line of the Parampara, who represents the message of the Supreme Lord, who is in connection with the divine message which has been coming down through Parampara, through the authorized traditions, the authorized sampradayas, about which we will discuss later. But here what I am saying is, this shloka is very important when you want to come to the 3rd house, or to any planet which is placed in the 3rd house, yes, or even if you don't have any planet, because the 3rd lord will be sitting somewhere, yes. So 3rd house shows our discomforts. Should I repeat? 3rd house shows discomforts, because it is 12th from the 4th house. 4th house shows our comforts, so loss of comforts. It shows traveling. It is the house of Purushartha, as they say, hard work, Parishram in Hindi, hard work, perseverance, all these things are there in the 3rd house. That is why if there are planets like the ruler of the 10th house placed in the 3rd house, then it is said that the person has to do something of his or her own, yes, otherwise he or she may not be able to carry on in a normal job here. I am just giving an example here. But it is also a Dusthana. Do you know the reason why? Because it is opposite of the 9th house. Yes, that is one of the main reasons why this is called a Dusthana, because this 3rd house is known as the house of the Rambo. Rambo means I will do whatever I want. I can do whatever I want, because that is the house of Purushartha. Purushartha means trying to change things by my free will. Yes, and it is also a Upachya house. 3, 6, 10, 11. These four houses are known as Upachya houses, which means that you have the power to improve things in the 3rd house. Yes, which means if there's a planet there, you have the strength to improve that planet by using your own free will. Yes, So in that way, it is a good house. But the problem is, when you are in the third house, or when there is, when I say you, it means if you have any planet in the third house, all right? So it means that you can have too much courage, which can be good or which can be bad at times. When is it good? When you are pursuing a spiritual path, that is fantastic for that. But when you are not pursuing a spiritual path, all right, if you are just indulging in mundane things, materialistic things of this material world, then also you are very courageous. So that is where the problem comes. So if somebody has prominent planets in the third house, I've seen that. Anytime you give them some good advice, and I'm not saying that I have been giving good advice to them, but I'm saying that even if I see these people getting actual good advice from somebody, then they can't listen to it, because the problem is they think they know everything. With prominent planets in the third house, or even if there are many planets in the third house, yes. So because of that, what happens? They are bereft of the blessings of God. And because of that, because they want to change things themselves, they have a hard time in this world. Yes. So we have to understand that the principle of karma and daiva goes hand in hand. So karma means, karma has many meanings, of course. But when I say karma here, I simply mean that karma is in one level our actions, but in the level of karma which I speak for this video is, okay, whatever is destined to happen, that will happen anyways. You can't change it. All right. That is called daiva, sorry, okay. And karma is the opposite. Karma says you can change everything by your by your free will. Yes. So there's this balance between daiva and karma. So daiva says don't do anything, just you don't have to do anything, everything will happen automatically, everything will happen by divine will, by divine arrangement. But karma says no, it is not like that, you can change things. Yes. So now there is a controversy that, oh, is everything destined or can we change things in this world? Yes. So the answer to that question is yat kripa tamaham vande shri gurum dina tarinam, which means if the guru wants, if God wants, then only you can change your fate, your destiny. Otherwise it is not possible. See, if that would be possible, then anybody and everybody would change things, right? So that doesn't mean that you cannot change things. It simply means that when God blesses you, only then the destiny can be changed. All right. And destiny changes does not mean in a mundane level that, okay, this was supposed to happen, it doesn't happen. It doesn't mean that. It simply means that the lessons which you were supposed to learn, if God wants, then you will be able to learn it even without going through that level of suffering. Yes. Or on the other side, even if you are going through that level of suffering, you may still not learn the lessons. So what is the use of suffering then? Yes, because ultimately the purpose of suffering is to give you lessons, that you did bad to somebody, so now the same thing is coming back to you. All right. So coming back to this shloka, mukam karoti vachalam. Why I'm speaking of this shloka is, whenever there are planets in the third house, yes, let's talk with example. Suppose you have Venus in the third house, suppose you can have any planet. But why I'm taking example of Venus is because it's very easy to understand for this example. For this case, if somebody has Venus in the third, and yes, now I will tell something and then everybody will start writing, oh, I have Venus in the third, you're lying, I'm not like this, it doesn't work like that, you don't know, you're just fooling people. You want, that day somebody wrote in comments, I was, I started laughing when I saw the comment. Somebody wrote that, oh, I am trying to fool people, I am trying to create terror, fear, so that I want people to take consultation from me and then I can get their money. Yes. So I don't know. I mean, my days are not that bad, as in Hindi they say na, mere itne bhi bure din nahi aaye ki logo ko dara ke paise lene ka ye hai na, aisa bhi din nahi aaya. I have not seen such bad days that I have to create terror in the heads of people. Yes. If I wanted to do that, and I could have done it from the day one of this channel. Yes, only speak terrorizing things. Oh my God, Venus in this house, this will happen, that will happen. But that's not the way how I approach. So now, depending on other situations, suppose Venus is in third house, suppose, all right. And in that case, what can happen is, you may be too much confident about your relationships, or you may think that I don't need any advice from anybody pertaining to that planet. Suppose Mercury is there. So sometimes you may think, oh, I'll do this financial, I'll invest there. Yes, because Mercury represents finances. So you may think that I'll invest there. But you may miss out on good advice which somebody gives you. Okay. So whenever you have planets in the third house, then it is very much recommended that you seek the ninth house of advice. Yes. Especially divine, enlightened gurus, personalities who can share the wisdom of the scriptures with you. Because then what happens, most of the times our own decisions take us into trouble, right? Am I right here? Anybody disagrees? No. Because most of the times it is we ourselves who decide wrong things. Yes. Now somebody will object to this and say, oh, I wanted to do this, that person told me, but ultimately we only took the decision, right? So whenever we have planets in the third house, it is essential that we seek the blessings of the gurus when we are going to start anything pertaining to that. Suppose somebody's seventh lord is placed in the third house. Seventh lord shows the first relationship, first prominent relationship, or the first physical relationship. Yes, in ancient times there was only marriage, only one marriage. So in ancient times seventh house was only seen for marriage because there was one marriage. Yes, even in many countries till now, thankfully there are still only one marriages. But what I am saying is, suppose the seventh lord is in the third, then before you get into marriage, yes, before you get married to somebody, then it is recommended that you do this in consultation with other senior personalities and especially your guru. Yes, you don't just whimsically go and decide something that, oh, I like this person, I will go and marry this person. Now, yes, somebody will say, I will do whatever I want. Who are you to say like that? No, I am not saying this. this the house is telling. Because then what happens? When you take the blessings of the guru may try to enlighten you regarding some blunders which you may be doing. And because it is a Dusthana, it is highly likely that we will make some blunders. Yes, planets in Dusthanas means we can make some blunders when it comes to those planets. Yes, so it is very much advisable when you have planets in the third, especially if it is a planet like Mercury, when you are going to invest money somewhere. For example, nowadays this Bitcoin thing is there. So many people are messaging me in WhatsApp, in email, and that, oh, what is your view on Bitcoin? What is your view on this? What is your view on that cryptocurrency? Now, what I say to them is, whatever you do, all right, before you do, if you have planets like Lord of the 11th house or Lord of the 2nd house, or the Lord of the Lagna or Sun Moon there, yes, then be very careful when you invest. Do your research properly, talk to people who know about it, all right, for mundane things like money or investment, now where to put our resources. Yes, those are mundane things ultimately. So we need to take proper guidance before we take any decision pertaining to that. Yes, and especially if there are planets like Jupiter, then we may take some wrong decisions pertaining to our children or towards our spirituality. Yes, I have seen people with Jupiter in the third house making some blunders when they are starting their spiritual path. Yes, or what I have seen with this Jupiter in the third house people with this placement is, now this can reduce if Jupiter is in own sign. All right, so for example, if somebody is a Capricorn ascendant, then Jupiter will be in the sign of Pisces. Yes, or for a Libra ascendant, Jupiter will be in the sign of Sagittarius. So for these two ascendants, the results can be a bit less. But in general, what I have seen is Jupiter in the third house, instead of following what the scriptures say, they will try to take out some own path. They will think, oh, maybe I should not do this mantra, I should twist the mantra. See, it doesn't work like that, because mantras are like passwords, all right? So mantra is what basically? Mana trayate, that which delivers the mind. So I had one example of one person whom I told to chant this mantra because he was under a Saresati. I told him to chant Om Namah Shivaya. Yes, one mala in the night. Mala means 108 times. But then this person, whimsically, what he did? Now, I'm not saying that he had Jupiter in the third, but some similar combinations were there. The third lord was placed in a particular placement, which I will not tell because that's his personal chart. But what I told him was Om Namah Shivaya, and then this person, after 2 months, he called me and said, oh, you told me to chant, my problems are increasing after chanting this mantra. I said, it can't happen. You are doing some blunder, something stupid you are doing, because of that this is happening. I said, are you chanting Om Namah Shivaya and are you chanting in the night? He said, yeah, I am chanting in the night, but I don't like this mantra, so I have not twisted it. I said, seriously, I have made it Om Shivaya Namah. So basically what's happening is, when you are chanting Om Namah Shivaya, now that is a big explanation which I will not give here. The difference between Om Namah Shivaya and Om Shivaya Namah, those are big, big, big difference. There's a very big difference. And chanting Om Shivaya Namah when you are not at the highest level of celibacy can be very dangerous, because when you are chanting Om Shivaya Namah, what you are doing is, you are saying Shiv first. Yes, Om Shivaya Namah. That means you are saying that I want to be close to Lord Shiva. Yes, but when you are saying Om Namah Shiva, you are saying Namah before Shiva, which means that you respect Lord Shiva from a distance. And you are doing Namaskar, you are saying, oh Lord Shiva, you are great. Now that is good for us. But if we say Om Shivaya Namah, yes, then what happens? We are saying, oh, as if we are Lord Shiva's very close intimate associate, like Nandi or Mother Parvati, somebody like that, or Sringi Bringi. We are not like that, yes, we are ordinary people. So then when we go close to Lord Shiva, if he sees Kamdev inside us, which is sex desire, yes, sex desire means any desire to enjoy objects of this material world. It doesn't include the opposite sex, it includes everything else actually. That's the highest interpretation of sex desire that the scriptures say. So in that case, Lord Shiva will open his third eye and he will burn you. Yes, so we should not chant this mantra, Om Shivaya Namah. This is just one example I am giving. And then I told this person, why are you chanting this mantra? I told you Om Namah Shivaya, you have changed the mantra. He said, but I don't like to chant that mantra. I said, if you don't like, then stop, but don't twist it. At least you will stay in hell, but you will not go to lower places of hell, right? Hell means not some planetary system where there is hell, but when I say hell, I mean his hellish situation which he is in this life, yes? So at least you will be crying and you will be sitting like that, yes? But at least you will not go into more hellish regions, yes? You will not cry more if you don't chant that mantra. So better than whimsically chanting mantras and trying to twist and turn it and give your own interpretations, best is to not chant if you don't want to chant the mantra. Okay, so that's what I wanted to say here. Now this can be true with pertaining to any other planet, sun, moon, or because any planet, it will be a natural significator of something, and then it will also be one of the lords. Yes, if it is sun or moon, then one, or if it is other planet, then it will be ruling two houses in the chart. So pertaining to that planet, we need to take divine guidance, and there is where this shloka comes. Mukam karoti vachalam pangum langayate grim yat kripa tamaham vande shri gurum dina tarinam, which means Taridam is deliverance, yes? It means the Guru has the power who can come and pull us out of this rakas of the third house. So whenever we have any planet, it is needed very much that we go and seek guidance from the Gurus, yes? And especially ninth house also represents elders. So elders and astrologers are also to large extent counted in the ninth house, yes? Although astrology is a mix of the 8th house and the 9th house, depending on what level of astrology you are giving. And by this level, I don't mean Jaimini, Parashara, Bhrigu, I don't mean all those. I mean that if you are simply using astrology to know how your partner will be or when you will get a job, then that's simply mundane astrology. Yes, but if you are seeing it as a journey of your spiritual path to see when you will encounter difficulties in your spiritual life, yes, how can you improve your life spiritually? Then it is a part of the ninth house. Otherwise, it is just dealing with garbage. The garbage of your karma, yes. Which is also okay. There's no problem with that. But that's not the ultimate aim of astrology. So, even astrologers can be considered in the ninth house, yes. Depending on what kind of an astrologer the person is, yes. So, especially Venus is there, then in the third house, then it's recommended that we can take help of astrology to check if both of us can lead a compatible life, which is this Kundli Milan, the Gun Milan, whatever you want to call it. Or if there are any planets like Jupiter, then also we can seek the guidance of the Guru. Yes, that am I not destined to have a child, or if there is some problem, then you must go. All right. I'm not saying that you will not have a child, but I'm saying if there are some problems, then please approach the Gurus and enlightened beings who can actually guide you. Because when you are opposite of the ninth house, you feel, I don't need anybody. I don't need to hear anybody's advice. So there comes the problem. So if we do what the ninth house tells us to do, yes, and that does not mean that you blindly go and say, okay, this astrologer told me, now go and marry this person. Then you blindly go and marry that person. No, it's not like that. You also meet the person, you also decide, you also deliberate, but along with that, you take help of the higher powers, yes, and blessings of the gurus and the scriptures, the enlightened personalities, that is very much needed when we have planets in the third house. And even if we do not have any planet, then also there is the third lord who is sitting somewhere, so those things can play there. Yes, suppose the third lord is in the seventh house, then the same dynamics can play, but in a different way. Yes, and third house, as we also know, it's the original house of Gemini, which is a dual sign, which represents the house of prostitution. Gemini represents prostitution. Yes, so basically third house can give us the feeling as if there is some kind of an activity at that level which is going on. Yeah, basically what happens when you go to a place where there is prostitution going, there is no count. Today somebody will come, tomorrow somebody else will come, today somebody will enjoy with that prostitute, today another person will come and enjoy with somebody else. So that kind of a feeling we can have sometimes if there are planets in the third house. For example, I have seen people with moon in the third house, their relationship with the mother is in doldrums sometimes, which means today it is good, tomorrow it is bad, today it is again good, tomorrow again it's bad. Venus in the third house, the same thing can happen. Today, oh, today my lover is there, tomorrow he's not there, again she's back after 6 months. This coming, going, this thing can happen. Yes, especially if Venus or seventh lord is connected with the third house, then these things can happen. So then we need to decide and we need to deliberate in guidance, with the guidance of the higher authorities of what is right and wrong, and then after taking guidance only we should finalize whatever is to be decided in the third house. All right, so that is it what I wanted to say pertaining to the third house. And again, this is not all in all, there are so many things, and maybe there are so many other things which I have not spoken due to the interest of time, because it's not possible that you speak about one house for 20 minutes and then the house is finished. That's never going to happen in astrology, at least. All right, so this is a basic summary of what to do if there are planets in the third house. All right, and that day somebody had asked me, oh, you said solutions to planets in the eighth house, but you did not mention about any planet in the eighth house. No, I do not want to go on all those things. Okay, Venus in the eighth house, Saturn in the eighth house, those things you can find in YouTube. But what I said in the video, that kind of information you might not find in other places. So I hope you understand what I mean here. Yes, and in this video I gave you some examples of Moon or Venus, because then again somebody will again write in the comments, so you didn't speak about any planet, you just explained what is the third house. Okay, so catering to the needs of those people, I have given some hints about specific planets in the third house. And now you can do your own research. You can also check charts of people, check your own life. All right, and then you can understand how to approach this planet. And yes, doing remedies pertaining to that planet will help very much, because it is a upacha house. So that's the best part about the third house. I mean, best in a way, you can say the best part, that you need to do remedies pertaining to that planet. All right, so whenever you whoever you know is very expert in suggesting remedies, mantras especially, and blessings, then you can go and take their blessings and start chanting the mantras. Yes, and then by that improve your lifestyle, and then the third house will not be a Dusthana anymore, because then your decisions which you finally take will be guided by the gurus, by the divine people, and the blessings of the gurus and God will be there. Yes, and by that the third house will probably not torment you that much the way it torments everybody now. All right, there you go, that is it from my side. If you want a consultation, then approach me through my website below. And if you're new, then please subscribe to it, and if you like this video, click the thumbs up. And if you want me to make any other video, then let me know in the comments. Okay, until next time, wish you good luck. Thank God finally the series of Dusthanas is over, and some other time I will speak more on the Dusthanas, alright? That is it from my side. Bye bye. See you.